Hello, my name is Sabine O'Hara, and I'm the Dean and Director of Land Grant Programs of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences, CAUSES for short. The economy has always been one of my fascinations. The field of economics concerns itself with three main questions. What do we produce? How do we produce it? And for whom do we produce? The how question is particularly fascinating to me. It drives everything else. I know most people will tell you that the for whom question is the critical one, and it is definitely important to concern ourselves with issues of consumption, needs versus wants, and just distribution. True. But the how is critically important, whether we need or want little or a lot. You might say the how is about the recipe we use to make things. If we make cars, for example, we can use more people and fewer machines, or fewer people and more machines to make them. And if we produce vegetables, we can use more fertilizer out of a bag or more compost. And the stuff out of the bag can be quickly applied, while composting takes time. And one method might be more work than the other. There is usually more than one way to do things, and everything we do has consequences, not only here and now, but in the most unexpected places and in the future. Economists call this how do we produce question the allocation question. We allocate our resources, determine which recipe to use to produce useful goods and services like cars, food, textiles, and a whole host of other things we need in our daily lives and things we don't need and that we use maybe once a year or once ever. If you like to cook like I do, you know what we do with recipes. We tinker with them. If I use a little bit more cilantro, what happens? And what about peppers or salt? Some things we can do without. My guacamole may not be as tasty without the cilantro, but I can make it. But if I have no avocados, I can't make a guacamole. When my grandmother's coffee cake recipe calls for 1 whole pound of butter and I use margarine instead, the substitution kind of works, but you can taste the difference no matter what anyone says. Sometimes there are good reasons for changing the recipe. If the price for meat keeps going up, I'll try a recipe for lentils that uses no meat, for example. The bottom line is, some substitutions work better than others, and some don't work at all. There are some things we simply can't do without, and those things we better not run out of. The same is true for the economy. There are many different ways to make things, and we constantly try to improve on our recipes and allocate our resources differently. Economists have three big buckets of inputs that are used to make this long list of goods and services that we produce. They are labor, capital, and natural resources or land. Labor is our human input, our muscle power, our pushing the button on the machine, typing things into the computer, moving the dirt on a construction site. But it is also our creative labor, our ideas, our ingenuity, and innovative work. Capital is a very big bucket of all of the human-made things that we use in the production process. Machines, tools, chemicals, it's a very, very long list of things. And then there are the natural resources that are not human-made, like oil, minerals, water, and so forth. Those we call land. We make a whole lot of stuff with these inputs. In the United States, we produce $17 trillion worth of final goods and services. That's $17,000 billion, or $17 million dollars worth of stuff. We call this measure of goods and services we produce minus the value of the goods and services used up in the production process the gross national product, or GDP. It's a measure of all the stuff we produce measured in dollars or monetary units so that we can add up all those different things like cars, computers, clothing, food, and so much more. The Bureau of Economic Analysis reports on this measure every 3 months And we all listen up when we hear that GDP went up by only 1% in the second quarter. Wow, not good. Really? Is that really what we should be paying attention to? The problem, you see, is that this measure of final goods and services that we pay so much attention to tells us nothing about how we made those things that we count in our GDP. And it tells us nothing about the side effects of those products, nothing about whether they were produced with very little labor input and a lot of water, or whether they created high unemployment and a lot of air pollution, or whether they created a lot of waste or conserved water. Nothing about any of that. So when we are so focused on whether the GDP goes up or not, we get only a tiny fraction of what is really going on when we produce the final goods and services that make up our GDP. Sure, we have more people on this planet, more mouths to feed. So we need more stuff. We need a higher GDP. So we focus a lot of our attention on the relationship between the inputs we use and the output we produce. Ideally, we want to produce more with less. More cars, refrigerators, iPads, food, building materials, haircuts, and so on and so forth, with less labor, less oil, less costs. We call that efficiency. So as we increase inputs, we create more output. But we want to change the recipe and create even more with those same inputs. We want to constantly push out that production function, as economists call it, up and out. Make more with less. Strange, too, that we seem to focus our efficiency efforts mostly on saving labor, rather than on saving water or energy or other material inputs. High unemployment has consequences. And some of our recipes use up a lot of natural resources that we cannot easily replenish. Some are tough on the labor force, or they are outright dangerous, like some mining methods, for example. So what else happens when we produce things? Some of the recipes we use to produce things create a lot of emissions that pollute our air and our water. Some of our recipes call for acres and acres of forest to be cut down. Some create so much waste that we have plastic garbage islands forming in the Pacific, and tiny pieces of plastic are suspended in our oceans almost everywhere, and our nuclear waste is buried in salt mines and deep underwater. Economists call these kinds of side effects of production externalities. A pretty telling term, isn't it? It's external to the purview of economics, and we don't count the side effects. But they are nonetheless real. You might picture them as an emission function under the production function. So as the recipe uses inputs to produce outputs of goods and services, we also produce emissions and waste. The more inputs used, the more emissions. There is actually a sizable body of knowledge about what these externalities cost us as a society. When air pollution causes asthma, there is a cost. When water pollution requires extensive cleanups, there is a cost. So we decided that it would be a good idea to change the recipe, to prevent emissions, or at least install scrubbers in smokestacks and filters in wastewater pipes that leave our factories so that we clean up the mess we create after the fact. So here the objective is to lower the emissions, not more with less, but less with more. Even as we increase the use of inputs, we want less emissions. This is what some of our technological innovations have focused on over the past 30 years or so. And we have made some progress, at least in this country and in much of Europe. But there are many places in the world where progress in reducing air and water pollution, for example, is still very much needed. But the picture is still more complicated. What happens with these workers, the water, the air, at the end of a long work week? What happens with the emissions and the waste that we create? They don't just disappear somewhere just because they are not used to produce things anymore. Take water, for example. If we fertilize our crops to grow food, we may inadvertently pollute our groundwater. For a time, the nitrate emissions in our groundwater may still be small enough to not create much of a problem. And the soil that sits between the top where the plants grow and down where the groundwater layer is may actually help us out, and it may buffer or absorb some of our emissions. But at some point, these absorptive or buffer capacities are exhausted, and we get increasing pollution levels in the groundwater, and at some point we can no longer use it as drinking water without spending a lot of money first to treat it. And what about us, the labor force? When we leave work, we are tired. We need to eat, rest, get loved and cared for. I call these kinds of inputs that provide rest, restoration and recreation our sustaining sink services. All human activity, economic and non-economic, draws upon a web of services provided in households, communities, and social networks, and in nature, in ecosystems, in the beauty we find at a riverbank or even in a neighborhood park. Without this web of caretaking, regenerative, and reproductive services, there is no creativity tomorrow, no innovation, no muscle power, and no more help from the soil to absorb our pollutants. Human communities and the communities of organisms that we call our environment all form a web of sustaining sink services that make future production first possible. But when we place too much pressure on these sink services, when we overload them, when everybody works so hard and runs so fast that they don't have time to socialize or rest or engage in democratic institutions and recreational activities, then our sink capacities collapse and we lose the ability to repair, process, and maintain our productive capacity. No more sink services. No more future production. This then is where the real work of innovation lies. Not just reducing emissions and waste, but strengthening sinks. How can we do that? How can we strengthen the sustaining sink services that do so much invisible, unrecognized, and undervalued work for us? Is there a way to increase the absorptive capacity of the soil? Can we increase buffer capacities rather than ruining them? Can we create networks of support? Can we try to figure out how to make our coworkers' jobs easier? Can we actually turn an emission into a new source? Can we extract the pollutants and turn them into resources? We know that it's possible. There are moments when we sense the energy and the strength that comes from participating in something that is greater than we ourselves. Nature gives us wonderful examples of the fact that it is never one entity that makes things work. It is always a web, a whole network of entities that make things work. So the real how do we produce question of economics is, how do we do it in a way that supports the web, that sustains the whole, and that recognizes the value of the visible inputs and the invisible sinks? Only a model of production that keeps all three components, inputs, emissions, and sinks in view, can be sustainable in the long run. So let's shift our focus a bit, and let's find new recipes that use inputs more efficiently, that reduce emissions and waste, and that strengthen sink services and turn sinks into new resources. That's where the real innovation and the real efficiencies lie. Our future will depend on finding those recipes.